responsibility. And now I call upon Dr. Corulla George to throw some light on the teratogeospermia in the limelight of current infertility practice. Sir is a pioneer of ART in India and is educational repute and also the head of reproductive medicine unit in Bangalore. Over to you, sir.
How do you change this? Oh, this way, eh? Okay. This way, okay, right. Good afternoon to all of you, and my topic is on teratozoospermia. Now, teratozoospermia is defined as abnormal sperm morphology, and usually when you have abnormal sperm, it means that fertilization will not occur, and that is basically because it's unable to enter into the eggs, and that is what's called teratozoospermia. Now, I'll just explain a few things. One is, this is what I'll be talking about. Create an awareness on teratozoospermia, then diagnosis, controversies, and management. Now, generally, when you have infertility, you must know what the reason is. Now, if it's a female part, it could be a female part or a male part. Now, if it's a male part, there's a problem with the sperm. Now, if it's a female part, it may be because of anovulation happening, or it may be tubal factors problem, or it may be because there's some problems in the uterus. And that is why infertility may not happen. But also, it's also can be called unexplained when everything else is normal. You check everything and everything else is normal, then it's called unexplained. But, and one thing is, there's no reason for infertility detected when it's unexplained. You don't really know what is the reason, why it's not happening. Now, normally, when you know that it's unexplained, you actually check to see what is the problem. So one thing is, you just check to make sure whether the periods are regular, and also whether the uterus is normal, and whether so that will be done by scan to see if there's any polyps or any fibroids or anything like that. And then also ideally you must also check the tube to see if the tube is patency. And then the husband will also be checked, and check the normal semen analysis will be checked. Then also you will wonder whether any physical or endocrine abnormalities, and also when you do a scan, you will look at the uterus look at the ovary to see whether it is normal in size, and also sometimes, and that is you're doing the AFC, and also you will do a blood test and check for AMH, and normally you expect it to be around 2 to 3.5. If it is less than 1, you say it's a problem, and if it's more than 3.5, it's more than 5, then you think of OHSS risk. Now, the only thing is, when you are checking for both uterus and the tubes, right? When you're checking for the tubes, usually the tube is done by doing HSG, or it is, and if that is looking okay, then it's all right. But suppose it's not showing properly, then you will think of doing laparoscopy. But traditionally, you should not do checking the tube. You should do it only after making sure that you have checked the husband's semen test. Because if the semen test is low, then you don't have to do laparoscopy, you don't have to do HSG. And actually, I'll just tell you, there were some patients who came to me who had already had laparoscopy done, and when we checked them, the husband had not been checked, and then when we checked them, there was a problem with that. So generally, it's not done, and it should not be done on a routine basis. It should be done only after if this semen test is normal, only, but that is standard. Now, according to the WHO, you say that the semen sample is according like this, 1.5, then 39 million, sperm concentration 15 million, and progressive motility is 32%. But sperm morphology, what they're saying is, normal is more than 4%. But if it is less than 4%, then it is called teratozoospermia. And that is when the sperm morphology has got a problem. And that is when it is less than 4%. But there's also one problem. There's some other articles which also say that it should not be like 4%, and that will be explained later. And actually, even the WHO in 1980, what they had mentioned was 50% are normal and 50% are abnormal, then it is called teratozoospermia. But in 2010, they have now said that it is anything less than 4%, only then it is called teratozoospermia. Now, for male factor problems, the sperm may be damaged, and these are the different problems. One is oligospermia, and that is basically low number of sperm. That is called oligospermia. Now, asthenospermia is when there's poor sperm movement, and teratozoospermia is when there's abnormal shaped sperm. And azoospermia is when there is absence of sperm in the ejaculate, and this is due to obstructive or non-obstructive reasons. Now, sometimes also you will have a combination between oligo, asteno, and teratozoospermia, a combination. And so that will be low number of sperms, poor sperm movement, and also abnormal sperms. And then it is called oligo, asteno, teratozoospermia. That is how it's called. But that happens often, but it's not on a routine basis, but sometimes that happens on a routine basis, and it is because all three are having a problem. And that is when it's called oligoasthenoteratozoospermia. Now, the other problems is when you call it cryptozoospermia, this is different things, and it's basically absent or fresh preparations, and hemospermia is when there's presence of erythrocytes in the ejaculate. Now, when you say erythrocytes, then it is called erythrocytes is it's a different thing problem, and hemospermia, basically erythrocytes, it's basically saying that hemospermia, erythrocytes, is basically when erythrocytes means blood cells, and it's called red blood cells. And when it's called leukospermia, then white blood cells are present in all the ejaculates, and that is the thing. And then the other one is necrozoospermia. Now, when necrozoospermia, it means that all the sperms are dead. So that is when it's called necrozoospermia. And when it's also called incomplete necrozoospermia, and that is when a few will be normal. So that is what's called necrozoospermia. Now, how will you increase the percentage of abnormal sperm? Now, according to the WHO, it is saying that it is 4%, but as I had mentioned earlier they had said it is 50%. And abnormal sperm, what happens when you have abnormal sperm? Now, abnormal sperm, it can be in the head, or it can be in the middle section, or it can be in the tail. But sometimes it can be on one side, on both sides, or all three sides. So, but one thing is, when it is more on the head, then it causes a major problem. If it's on the middle part or on the tail, then it doesn't cause very much of a problem. And causes for infertility is abnormal sperm unable to enter the eggs, and that is why fertilization doesn't take place. And this is what is normal, and you can see that that's the head, and this is the midpiece, and this is the tail part. Now, so this is what's called as normal sperm. Now, the only thing is, the first one is normal, and all the others are abnormal ones. Now, when you're looking at the upper ones, it is only on one side, and the second one is on both sides, up and down, and the third one is all three parts are having a problem. So this is what's calling a problem. Now, so this is how it is, and this is the problem that happens. Now, the thing is, how will you check it? Now, basically, it is checked under high magnification. That's how it's generally done. I'll come to that again. So this is what is human reproduction update in 2013, and basically it is saying that you're looking at it's checked with high magnification. That's why it's 660. It is checked like that, and also it is because the vacuoles are on the larger side, and that is why the size of the head is on the higher side. And when the head is on the other side, then on the larger side, then it causes a problem for infertility. So this is also another thing which can happen, and this is Human Reproduction 2013. Now, also called teratospermia is also called teratospermia, and it's basically defects in the head, midpiece and tail, and ideally you need to confirm the semen analysis and shape of sperm under the microscope. Now, one more thing is also, even though when you do a semen test first and you find that it is less than 4%, then what you should ideally do is you should repeat it after 1 month. And then if it is still like that, then you will call it teratospermia, because you should not do it the first time you do it, you should not call it teratospermia. It is generally done only if it is repeated and it is still causing a problem, only then you will call it as teratospermia. And according to the WHO 2010, 96% are normal, but there's also one Kruger's criteria which says that 85% are abnormal. So when it's 85% are abnormal, it means that 15% are normal, and for WHO it is only 4% are normal. So we are not really sure which is the better one, but according to this thing, it may be either 15% or 4%, and it's according to WHO and Kruger's differences. And usually if it is 15%, then the chance of pregnancies, even natural pregnancies, on the higher side, because that can also happen. So this is also how the possibility is. Now, why does teratospermia happen? And it is problems in the testis, and also if they are having problems like smoking, alcohol, tobacco, and that sort of thing, that also causes teratospermia, and also diet problems, vasectomies, diabetes, any fevers, and inappropriate habits. And these are the reasons why teratospermia can happen. So then also, if it is something like that, then it can be treated in a different way very easily. Right, so that is also there. Now, the other thing also is, if there is cancer treatments, if it is like they've already had cancer treatment, chemotherapy or radiotherapy, then also it can cause a problem. And any bacterial infections, any testicular trauma, even varicoceles, even then that can cause a problem. And unhealthy habits, like unbalanced diet, exposure, and then occasionally it may be because of a genetic problem also, but usually in teratospermia, genetic problems is not there. But occasionally it can happen, occasionally. So, but most likely it is not, it doesn't cause a problem for teratospermia, genetic problems. Now, teratospermia, abnormal sperm, as I said, 4% normal. Now, there's also something new called teratospermia includes globosospermia. And globosospermia basically means that in the head, the acrosome is not there. So then, and the acrosome is the one which helps them to enter into the egg. And if the acrosome is not there, then that is not possible. So that is called globosospermia. And there's another thing also called macrosospermia, when the head is very large. So that's also called macrospermia. So this is also, when teratospermia is there, it can also be called teratospermia and globosospermia, and also teratospermia and macrosospermia. And these are the two different types, and that will also be explained. Now, is it possible to, when they have teratospermia, can you cure it? Now, suppose it's a problem with fever, infections, stress, smoking, and that sort of thing, then you can advise them and tell them to stop all that, and then check the semen test again several times, and then it may come up. And so that is also one thing, and sperm quality can come up. So that is one thing that usually happens if it is because of something like this. Then, because originally we said 15% may be normal, so then it can be called as mild if it is 10 to 14%, and moderate if it is 5 to 9%, and severe if it is less than 4%. And as I also mentioned, if it is mild and moderate, then the chances of even natural pregnancy or simple things you can treat, then you can do things. But if it is severe, then it is a little more difficult to handle it. Now, why does pregnancy not happen? And that is because abnormal sperm cannot swim properly, unable to enter the fallopian tubes by themselves, and unable to enter the oocytes. And fertilization will not happen. That's why. Now, occasionally, chromosomal abnormalities may happen, but it usually doesn't happen on a routine basis. And suppose, but if a chromosome problem is there, then and fertilization happens, then implantation may not happen. But even if implantation happens, then miscarriage is likely to happen. But this is not on a routine basis, and it's very occasionally done. It's normally you don't expect it in teratozoospermia. Now, this is globosospermia, and basically the head, the acrosome is not there, and then because the round-headed spermatozoa lacking an acrosome, then acroscome is required to penetrate the zona pellucida. And so then if it is acrosome is not there, then their entrance is not possible. So that is when it's globosospermia, that's a major problem. So then but one thing is, when there's globosospermia, there's no symptoms, no chromosomal abnormalities, and ideally you'll think of doing ICSI and that sort of thing. And also you'll think of doing, ideally you think of oocyte activation also should be done together at the same time. So this will be beneficial for globosospermia. Now, this is when you look at globosospermia, you can see the acrosome there. Now, if the acrosome is not there, then it is called globosospermia. And this is a human reproduction in 2013, in saying that it's globosospermia is a rare and severe teratozoospermia, and characterized by a round-headed spermatozoa without acrosome. An acrosome is required for entry and penetrate the zona pellucida, and no chromosomal abnormalities. And when ICSI is done, success rates are a little on the lower side. And when ICSI with associated activation, the success rates are on the higher side. And also they're saying that IMSI may also be beneficial to identify the problem. But even when IMSI is being done, you should also think of oocyte activation. So this is according to the human reproduction. And so this is, if you're having globosospermia, you can think in terms of treating it in that way. Now, for macrozoospermia, this is sperm cell head has extra chromosomes. And usually when the chromosomes are, normally it's only one, should be one, but when it is four, then it causes a large head for the sperm. And the head will be very large, and abnormal sperm, fertilization will not happen. And the head of the sperm also have male's genetic information can be there. And this is how it is, and this is the, and sometimes the tails also may have a problem. But basically it is the head is on the large side. And because of the additional genetic material, embryos will not develop, or pregnancy will result in miscarriage, but will happen traditionally. And this is what it looks like when the head is very large. Now, the other thing is Y chromosome microdeletions. Now, that is usually for azoospermia. You will have the chromosome problem in azoospermia. But occasionally, even for teratozoospermia, it may be there, but that is very unlikely to happen. And it's usually detected with sperm DNA from teratozoomous patients. And teratozoospermia may be related to gonadal mosaic Y chromosome. And Y chromosome also seen in patients with varicocele. So that's also there. Now, how will you improve the sperm quality? Now, one thing you can give is antioxidants, L-carnitine, vitamins, and improve sperm quality, especially if due to diet problems. And also healthy lifestyle and eating habits should be also different. So then you can think of improving sperm quality, and then they can even try naturally. Now, according to many articles, but these are all old articles, 1996, saying that antioxidants for male factor is beneficial. And this is a Cochrane review in 2011 saying that improve the outcomes of live birth and pregnancy rate for subfertile couples undergoing ART cycles. And this is a Cochrane review which I had checked recently in March 2019. So what they have mentioned now is saying that it may increase in the success of live birth, and clinical pregnancy says also on the higher side, but no evidence of increased risk of miscarriage, and only 7 small RCTs. And what they've also mentioned is that it's low quality evidence. So further large, well-designed RCTs are required to confirm benefits of antioxidants for male factor. But it is supposed to be beneficial. So antioxidants can be used initially for patients with this sort of a problem. Now, how will you do treatment? Now, the first of all, men with teratozoosperma should change their lifestyle and quit unhealthy habits for their organism, such as cigarette smoking or alcohol drinks. Also take antioxidants, L-carnitine, vitamin E, which helps in sperm quality. And so that is important in the beginning. And most likely, only if the head has got a problem, then you will have this problem, the light problem. Now, as mentioned, the sperm head, it could be in the head, midpiece, or the tail. But occasionally, it's also mentioned that natural pregnancy can happen when there are some few normal sperms. So that also can happen. But so then that is important. If you can still, even if it's 4% of normal sperms, occasionally that can also happen. But that may not happen on a routine basis, but it can happen. And then if it is a mild teratospermia, then you can think of doing IUI. Because mild teratospermia is 15 to 10% will be normal. So then you can think of doing IUI. But if it is moderate or severe, then you will think of doing IVF, ICSI, PICSI, or IMSI. And IMSI may be beneficial, but it is a little difficult to do for the embryologist also. So, but that also is got some benefit as compared, and that will be explained also why. Now, IMSI, fertilization rate, when you look at ICSI versus IMSI, it's almost the same. And the cleavage rate is almost the same. And embryo quality, there's no difference. But when they're looking at the pregnancy rate, the RCT is saying that with IMSI, it is 39% versus 26%. So its IMSI seems to be slightly on the higher side. Now, when you're doing ICSI, the microscope with magnification of around 400. But when you're doing IMSI, the magnification around 6,500. And that will take at least 1 hour to do it. Well, the other ones will take only 10, 15 minutes. But IMSI will take 1 hour. And it is very difficult for the embryologist to do it. Now, when you're looking at the fertilization, can abnormal sperm result in fertilization, and depends on the type of the problem. Now, if it's only on one part, then it's more likely to have a fertilization is possible, if it's only on one side. But if it is on both sides or all three sides, then it's got a problem. But if it is more only on the head, then it has got a problem. But if it's on the midpiece or tail, then it's unlikely to happen. It can happen. And miscarriage will happen, but usually not. But if there's a genetic problem, only then miscarriage will happen. Now, one more thing is, when you're having an embryologist, you should have a good embryologist. And ideally, you should not have a visiting person. You should have somebody who's already there and trained well in IVF, and ideally for at least two years, and should be able to see the normal and abnormal sperm, because they are the ones who are looking at it. And sometimes it may not be possible to actually know whether it is an abnormal sperm or a normal sperm, and that will also be a problem. And so they should be able to know how to do things like that properly. And then ideally they can think of doing PICSI or ICSI and with normal sperm or even a single problem, but especially a normal, but not double or triple. So that's also a problem. And IMSI is difficult for them to do it also. So ideally you should have a good embryologist in that, especially when you have this sort of a problem. And there have been some, there was some patients of us who had, and when it was done for them, we got something like 15, 20 eggs, but only one or two were normal. And that is probably because of teratospermia, but only one or two were normal, and those were injected, and that happened, worked out. And if you have an excellent embryologist, then your success rates are much on the higher side. Now, when you're doing PICSI, this is how you do it, and this is how you'll be able to check, and you'll be able to get the good quality sperm. And advantages of PICSI is ensure selected sperms are mature, lower risk of aneuploidy, better embryo quality and implantation rates. But the evidence is not much improvement in fertilization rates and pregnancy rates, but PICSI also seems to be a little bit slightly more beneficial. Now, the other thing is, suppose all the sperms are abnormal and they've ejaculated and given the sperm to you, then you will look at everything, and if the embryologist says that all of them are abnormal, nothing can be done, then you will think of getting it from the testis. So then you will think of doing PISA or TISA and TESE, and also you can think of doing micro TESE. And that is, you can get, hopefully you're hoping to get normal quality sperms. Now, only thing is, according to the rules, they're saying that micro TESE is ideally better than TESE. But that is a little difficult to do because it is done under an anesthetist and it is done differently. So then usually you will do, at least what we do is usually we do TESE or TISA, and if that is not working, then you will think of doing micro TESE. And this is how it's micro TESE is done. And micro TESE is done under anesthesia, and you look at the seminiferous tubules and remove small quantity of testicular tissues. So only a small, because when you're doing TISA, you'll be taking it from different places. But when you're doing it with the micro TESE, you're doing it only from one particular place. So then the damage to the testis also will be on the lower side. But ideally, when you're doing micro TESE, you may have to have a urologist to do it, because it will be difficult for us to do it for micro TESE. But most of us will be doing TISA and TESE, but doing micro TESE will be difficult, and ideally you should have to get a micro urologist to be with you, or at least get it to. But the only thing is, when it is done in the theater, then the sperm is taken, then it has to be immediately sent to the lab, because they have to check everything like that. So you'll have to have somebody there so that it will be immediately taken. It should not be taken later on. So this is how micro TESE is done. Now, DNA fragmentation is also sometimes done, but less than 15% it is considered as normal, and if it is 15 to 25%, it's said average, it's okay. But when it's more than 25%, then you say it is poor fertility problems. And how to handle? Basically, if you find that there's a problem with DNA fragmentation, then you will think of lifestyle modifications, and then you can think of giving antioxidants and all that sort of thing. And all that is given first, and then if that doesn't work, then you will think of a different problem. Now, one more thing is, should donor sperm be done for teratospermia? Now, this is the human reproduction, and what it's saying is that it's 102 donor cycles versus 94 teratospermia patients. Now, teratospermia was less than 20% normal sperm, but not less than 10%. And this is a little different in the sense that normally we say 4% less is called teratospermia, or 15% is normal sperm, but then this is what the Human Reproduction has mentioned, and but they're saying that it is not less than 10%. And fertilization and number of embryos was on the lower side for teratozoospermia as compared to donor. But pregnancy rates also was 18% versus 28%, where compared to teratozoospermia versus donor. And also, but one thing also they mentioned is the take-home baby rate comparable, 21% versus 24%. So that's almost same. So generally, we suggest that donor should not be done immediately. You will think of doing it only if you have done 2-3 times, it is not working out, and then you will think of doing donor. So this is the traditional way of doing, treating teratozoospermia patients. Now, this is the recommended practice. Female found to be normal, and check SA, and showing abnormalities, only then it's called as teratozoospermia. And then you have to do all the blood tests, check for them. And then teratozoospermia should be cured due to fever problems or infections or smoking or that sort of thing. Then you must make sure that all that is cured before before any treatment is done. And then you, as you need to recheck the semen sample again several times. And around 15% is normal, then you think of doing IUI. But if it is less than 4% normal, then you think of doing PICSI or ICSI or IMSI. So this is recommended practice. And still not working, then you will check a genetic abnormality. If it's not working, you'll just do a check or a DNA fragmentation, and that is just check to make sure there's no chromosomal abnormalities. But that is usually not done, and only if it is not working for a long time, then only you'll think of doing that on a routine basis. And ideally, you should have an embryologist who's an excellent person and be able to do all this on a proper way, because that is very important. Because if you don't have a proper embryologist, then they may not be able to tell you whether it is abnormal sperm or normal sperm or that sort of problem, or they may not be able to do IMSI or ICSI and that sort of thing. So this is how the practice is recommended. Okay, thank you.
Well, that was all about the abnormal sperms. Thank you, sir, for making it so simple for us to understand. We would welcome any questions from the audience.